Imagine you're starting a game series. To pull that off, you'd probably start with an iconic character, one that's instantly recognizable and that you can plaster all over the marketing materials. And this is also a character that we'll see grow and change throughout the franchise. You probably also want to have a richly defined world and an overarching plot that each entry will expand upon and reveal more about as we go along. Lastly, you should probably establish a solid gameplay foundation that you slowly and very incrementally build upon as the series goes on, without any abrupt changes that might alienate your player base. This would be the conventional wisdom for developing a video game franchise. So it's kinda wild that the Final Fantasy series has never really followed any of it. And yet, 37 years and 16 main series titles later, it's still going. From title to title, Final Fantasy games take place in a brand new world with a brand new cast each time. And the gameplay, especially in recent incarnations, differs drastically with each new sequel. So change has been a constant in the series, even back in its early days of top-down tiled maps and turn-based combat. Specifically, fans observed a pattern in the first five Final Fantasies, perceiving the odd-numbered games to be mechanics-focused, while finding the even-numbered titles to be more story-driven. Now, the problem I find with these sorts of overarching rules or patterns for a series is that they tend to be oversimplistic. They also tend to involve a fair amount of fudge factor and hand-waving to make work. My mind goes to the even-numbered Star Trek films are the good ones narrative, which compels me to remind you of Star Trek Nemesis.
I saw it in theaters, you must suffer as well!
Overall, I can see where folks are coming from with regards to the pixel era Final Fantasies, but this mechanics versus narrative framing is really reductive. I'd like to reframe this observation with a more detailed and hopefully insightful perspective. And more importantly, I want to discuss how Final Fantasy VI broke this pattern and blazed a mechanical trail which would lead to one of the most fascinating and beloved systems in the series, Final Fantasy VII's Materia. I talked at great length about Final Fantasy VI's narrative in my previous video. Now, if that sounds intriguing to you, I would certainly love for you to queue it up and watch it as soon as you're done watching this video. But just be warned that you're probably going to get some tonal whiplash as a result. There's a lot of heavy subject matter in that one, and I'm trying to be much more brisk and upbeat here. That one's quite serious, this one's just some fun game design observations. I bring this to you as not just another rando on the internet. I'm a technical game designer with 8 years of professional experience working in the industry. So anyhow, let's get into how Final Fantasy VI changed the course of the series game design and laid the foundation for its biggest hit, in my professional opinion. I want to introduce to you the concept of plasticity. No, I'm not talking about the stuff clogging up our oceans that's made from the stuff that is also setting our planet on fire. You vocabulary nerds out there will know that plasticity is the opposite of rigidity. Plasticity refers to the ability to be molded or shaped. Wet clay is highly plastic, for instance. I'm using plasticity to describe the player's capacity to alter and change their player characters or avatars in a game. And since games are multifaceted, plasticity manifests along those various facets. Narrative plasticity involves player choices molding their character's personality, role, and alignment in the story. Think Baldur's Gate 3 and how some of these dialogue choices and actions can radically change your character's reputation and place in the world. Aesthetic plasticity describes how much you're able to alter your character's appearance to your liking. Character creators give you a high degree of this aesthetic plasticity, and I'm back to the well of BG3 as my example here because I was already rummaging through this footage. But things like being able to change your character's clothing or hairstyle also count here. So the Final Fantasy series doesn't have a ton of either narrative or aesthetic plasticity. That is, the player doesn't have much influence over the writing or appearance of the protagonists. But what folks were getting at with the odds and evens observation is the game-to-game variations in mechanical plasticity throughout the series. You've probably already extrapolated its meaning, but just in case, mechanical plasticity is the ability for you as the player to shape how your avatar plays. Skill trees, different gear loadouts, choosing your class or abilities, all these things grant mechanical plasticity. In Final Fantasy I, the player chooses the jobs of the four party members. For those unfamiliar, job is the series terminology for its RPG classes like Knight, Thief, White Mage, etc. Final Fantasy II is a bit of an outlier as it ditches jobs in favor of a stats growth model based on usage. Then Final Fantasy III introduced the first job system to the series, where at any time the player can assign the jobs of their protagonist from a growing set of options. Final Fantasy IV went to fixed jobs for every character, with a notable exception for the main character who transitions from a Dark Knight to a paladin due to story events. Final Fantasy V brought back the job system, with the addition of a base freelancer job which enabled the player to compose their characters with stats and abilities they mastered from other jobs. So it's really Final Fantasies 3, 4, and 5 where this mechanics versus story observation holds the most water. Final Fantasy 1 offers a choice of jobs at the start of the game, but after that you're locked in. 2 actually has a fair amount of plasticity with its stat growth system, though I imagine that trying to build up new skills on a character later in the game is not ideal. Thus, the character's roles begin to calcify after a certain point. But starting with 3, we can swap jobs at any time, a feature which 4 would take away, but then 5 would re-establish. So why alternate between rigidity and plasticity like this? Well, this is speculation on my part, but there was a good degree of staffing continuity at Squaresoft during this pixel era of Final Fantasy. Sure, there were some departures and new additions over those years, but much of the dev team remained the same from title to title. And this afforded them opportunities to tinker and experiment with the formula and observe how it impacted each new game. Here they might have been exploring the downstream effects of this mechanical plasticity on various design concerns and content creation. In doing so, I think they discovered some of the strengths and drawbacks that exist on both ends of this plasticity spectrum. And this is one thing I want to stress to you. A more plastic game is not better than a rigid one, merely different. What do I mean by this? Well, let's start with a hypothetical game with a high degree of mechanical plasticity. The benefits of this are immediately obvious. Players have a number of dials and levers to find, adjust, and fine-tune a playstyle that they really enjoy. But this freedom comes at a cost. More options, of course, means more testing and debugging for the developers. But a wide variety of options also makes content creation significantly more difficult. Designers now have to plan and balance encounters and dungeons for a number of different combinations and permutations of player choices. This means they can't assume that the player will have any one particular class or skill. Well, I mean, they could. It just makes the player's choices either hollow or guesswork, both of which are really frustrating and bad design. And not only is this content harder to properly balance, it can also feel much more generic as a result. There are clever ways to make a game truly responsive and adaptive to a variety of playstyles, but this can be quite tricky to pull off well. Again, this probably requires more developer hours to produce, test, and debug content, so you're likely getting less of it in return. A more mechanically rigid game inverts these concerns. This means that you may be saddling your audience with a playstyle they don't care for, but now you can make far more accurate assumptions about their skill set or loadout at any point of their playthrough. This means you can really tailor your levels and encounters to match the player's options, granting more control over the pacing and difficulty and so forth. So for 5 games, the Final Fantasy series bounced around between mechanical rigidity and plasticity. But Final Fantasy VI would disrupt this back and forth by synthesizing these two approaches together. The player characters of Final Fantasy VI are both rigid and plastic. They're rigid in the sense that each character has a unique ability, a sort of partial fixed job, if you will. Edgar is a machinist, granting him the tools command, while Shadow as a ninja has the ability to throw weapons like Edge could in Final Fantasy IV. But through equipable modules, namely espers and relics, we can mold these characters into radically different roles. Many of the relics are just itemized abilities from Final Fantasy V's job system: cover, counterattack, jump, mug, dual cast, etc. Espers, also known as magicite, on the other hand, teach magic, so you can make any character a black, white, or red mage. The espers also grant stat boosts like strength or magic power on level up, allowing you to make your characters more effective physical fighters or spellcasters, respectively. So Final Fantasy VI characters aren't quite the mechanical blank slates that the Warriors of Light are from Final Fantasy V, but they're not entirely on rails like Final Fantasy IV's protagonists. They're more like RPG Mad Libs, with some words being provided for you by the designers, but a bunch of blank spaces for you to fill in on your own. And that's a really clever and fun approach. Now, even the most elegant and inspired game design solutions like this will fail if they're greatly limited by the environment they operate in. I speak, of course, about game content, dungeons, encounters, gear, and so on. And it's very clear that the developers of Final Fantasy VI understood this, because the rollout of content in this game is quite deliberate. As players, we don't get access to espers until the start of the second act of the narrative, right before the party seeks passage to the southern continent to eventually infiltrate the Magitek factory, some opera required. Likewise, most of the relics that grant impactful abilities don't come along until the back half of the game. What this means is that our characters are highly rigid at the start of the game, which the developers use to their advantage in the early goings. Many of these sequences and set pieces are built around particular character abilities, and that gives the first half of this game this sort of a bespoke, tailored feel. Take for example how Saban's Aura Bolt does holy damage, so it rips through the undead enemies of the Phantom Train, or how Celis's runic ability makes the snowfield battle against Kefka so much easier. But if these character-locked abilities were the best option throughout the entire game, there would be little incentive for us to learn magic or shape our characters into something different. Wisely, the dev team tuned these abilities and the content to gradually crossfade which strategy is optimal through the course of the game. The characters' unique abilities, especially Edgar's tools and Saban's blitzes, dominate the early game. Once the party gains access to more potent spells in the latter half of the game, however, said magic becomes the more effective approach for most things. There are obvious exceptions, but it's readily apparent in the back half of the game that the devs are intentionally rewarding players who make the most out of espers and relics. So was this synthesis of Final Fantasy IV's rigid characters with Final Fantasy V's highly plastic job system successful? It makes each character feel distinct, but at the same time, if you don't like the way a particular character plays, you can reshape them to your whims. Just look at Imp Dragoon Cyan Go here. Aw yeah. So yeah, I'd say it's a success, but the real innovation here was this modular approach, objectifying the various RPG abilities into magicite and relics. Final Fantasy VII would take the next logical step here and make this modularization all-encompassing under the Materia system. What were once unique character abilities like the Steel Command or Blue Magic, aka enemy skill, have now been transformed into orbs of Materia which can be used by any character. This decoupling is taken even further as Materia behave much more like FF6's relics than its espers. Instead of teaching a particular character a spell or ability, such things remain bound to their respective materia. So instead of Mad Lib's characters like 6, 7's heroes are back to being the blank slates of 3 and 5. In this case, however, they're more like sets of sockets in which the player can insert materia modules, composing all manner of hybrid jobs with the swappable building blocks. The only things that meaningfully differentiate the cast of 7 from each other mechanically are their weapons and their limit breaks. You can just lift up a particular combination of materia from one character and put it on another, and with some usually negligible differences in stats, they will play exactly the same way. This gives Final Fantasy VII a new style of plasticity and freedom with its characters that earlier entries in the series lacked. If you look at 1, 3, and 5, you'll notice that the party is the same four characters from beginning to end. For the most part, 5 puts a wrinkle on this. You spend the duration of these games building up these characters, so the game can't really change them out on you at any point without significantly impacting play. But because materia are decoupled and grow independently of the characters equipping them, this permits a much larger ensemble where the player can choose whichever characters suit them. It also allows FF7 to confidently move characters in and out of the party for story reasons, knowing that any impacts to the player's mechanical options will be manageable at worst. And I think this is why 7 is so beloved by so many people. You get to play your favorite characters, and you can quickly adapt them to whatever the situation demands. And the mechanical sting of a character leaving the party for, well, whatever reasons, is mitigated by the fact that you can just migrate their materia to another member of the cast. Now, personally, I prefer Final Fantasy VI's approach a bit more. 6 finds a sweet spot where each character adds something unique, but you can mold them into something else if you need or want to. On the other hand, the characters of 7 feel a bit too indistinct from one another in my opinion, and limit breaks are far too infrequent to make up that difference. That having been said, I think the materia system is brilliant. Genius, even. I especially love support materia and the emergent synergy that comes with them. My favorite and just an exquisite example of systems design is added effect. Pair it with Time or Hades, I definitely felt added effects absence in Remake Part 1. I'm still working my way through Rebirth, so maybe, hopefully, it will make an appearance this time around. And while we're on the remake, I think it's interesting how its approach has brought it more in line with 6 rather than the original 7. I'm talking about the unique character abilities, as well as some interesting asymmetries like long-distance enemies which can only be dealt with by Barret or Aerith. If you're not using magic, that is. I'm guessing Yuffie and Vincent may also help out in this regard in Rebirth. In this way, I think the new combat system finds the same sweet spot that 6 does, where each character has a unique playstyle, but you also have a wealth of options in the ensemble and Materia to choose from. Anyhow, the Materia system is awesome, and it only came about because the development team was constantly tinkering and experimenting with the series formula. I wish more game franchises did that, rather than tacking on bog-standard crafting systems and open-world busy work and calling it a day. This is my biggest problem with Rebirth so far, and if you followed this channel for some time, you know this is an axe I will probably grind until the day I die. So yeah, that's all I got this time around. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you hated it, a thumbs down. Also, mechanically speaking, what's your favorite Final Fantasy and why? Have at it in the comments below. If you'd like to support me and help this channel grow, you can share this video on your social media feeds. And if you've got some money burning a hole in your pocket, consider joining my Patreon. I'm going to be rolling out patron-exclusive game reviews soon, and if you join at the $3 tier, you can send me a question for my upcoming inaugural Q&A session. Hope to see you there. In the meantime, thanks for watching. Peace, love, and solidarity.